very warm welcome to St. James this morning. And we have some guests that we have here in our congregation this morning that we are welcoming as well. We have five missionaries from Through Faith Missions who will introduce themselves in just a minute. We want to welcome everyone who's joining us live on Facebook. Welcome, and we hope you enjoy the service today. And everyone who will be watching on YouTube on our YouTube channel later. Everything that you need is in the order of service that you received at the door or will be on the screen here in the front. Please do join in the words in bold or bright yellow. So at this time, I'd like to invite forward our Through Faith Missions team and have them introduce themselves just a little bit to let you know where they're coming from and a little bit about themselves. So if our Through Faith Missions team can come forward.
Good morning, everybody. My name's Dan, and I'm privileged to be the leader of this team. And I just want to thank you for your incredibly generous hospitality and reception last night, and we really look forward to getting to know you over the next couple of days. Thank you.
Morning, my name is Tao. A real privilege to be here with you all and worshipping God together. I just thank you for having us and for all your warmth and kindness. Thank you.
Well, good morning. I'd like to say thank you for having us too. It's been a wonderful privilege so far. My name's Paula. I'm usually a vicar in my own parish in Chigwell in Essex, but it's a privilege to serve you here this morning.
Good morning. My name's Gordon. I come from Northumberland, and it's a real privilege to be with you here, and we hope to be able to reach others and let them know about you this week, Lord.
Good morning, my name's Charles. I come from a long way away. I come from Cambridge. I joined on this adventure thinking it was going to be a hard time, and I was amazed by the hospitality that we received, and it looks as if God has really blessed us. So thank you very much for your hospitality, and we look forward to being with you over the next few days and spreading the word of God.
So let's pray for our missionaries. As they embark upon this journeying with us, engaging with people in our community and in Little Thetford this afternoon, and anyone else they join. Please let us pray. Heavenly Father, we lift up to you these five missionaries. We praise you for bringing them here to our neck of the woods. Lord, we just lift up their experiences. We pray that your Holy Spirit will be in the conversations that they have with people that they meet, and that people will engage with them, and that people's eyes and ears and will be open to you, Lord. We pray for your glory to be shining bright, especially these 3 days while they're here and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I have some bands of marriage that I need to read. So I published the bands of marriage between Kevin John Cox and Diane Elizabeth Redford, both of this parish. This is the third time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why they may or may not marry each other, you are to declare it now. Please let us pray for this couple. Heavenly Father, we just praise you for Kevin and Diane and the preparations for their wedded life together. Lord, we pray that you be the center of their marriage, the center of their family life to come. Lord, we lift them up to you, and we pray a blessing upon their marriage and a blessing upon their wedding day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let us stand, if you are able, to join me in the prayer of preparation. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thought of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And unfortunately, we are still not able to sing in church until tomorrow. But please do join in worshiping our Savior, our Lord, in our first hymn, My Jesus, My Savior.
Sound of your name.
Yes, that's the end of the song. We'll have Maggie come forward and read us our Bible readings. Please be seated.
Good morning. Readings today are John 15, verses 1 to 17. The vine and the branches. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. If you are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you, remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit, and apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like the branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything I have learned from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you, so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
John 13, just verse 35. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now Dan Holland from our Through Faith Missions will come and give us our sermon. I think I'll raise this for you.
Thank you. Thank you, Alan. Perhaps I'll just move it slightly. That's great. Well, good morning, everybody, once again. It really is a delight to be here with you, and I certainly feel the love of God embracing us this morning. I really feel his presence, and I hope you do. And I want to speak on these very famous verses out of Scripture. So famous, so poetic, such lovely imagery, that John passage, the vine and the branches. So beautiful. Jesus is the expert communicator of spiritual truth. And yet, because these words, these images are so beautiful, they're often lifted out of the larger context into which they are placed. And I've heard many sermons on the vine and the branches. I'm sure you have. And for me, it's always been about the fruits of the Spirit and about an inward life of fellowship with Jesus and staying connected to him. And all of those things are highly valuable and true, but there's a wider context into which these verses must be understood for us to get the full value out of them. And as I've prepared for this message, I've gone through a revolution in my understanding of what Jesus was saying. We have to remember that he's speaking to his disciples. It's the Last Supper, and he's about to go to the cross. He's about to go to the Passion, and he's preparing his disciples as best as he can for global mission. We have to understand these passages in the light of global mission. And your mission is very much at the centre of what TFM is doing. It's so lovely to have Paula's husband here this morning, the chair of the board for TFM, and also Steve and Jill, the founders of the VBR. How gratifying for us to have you here. Well, this is about mission. This passage is about mission. Jesus starts, as he so often does in the Gospel of John. It's another one of these teaching passages that we only find in the Gospel of John. He is the true vine, just like he's the true light, he's the true so many things, because Israel in the Old Testament is typified by being a vine. You know, you might want to go home this afternoon or this evening and just do some word searches on the vine in the Old Testament. There is a rich, rich tradition of Israel being described by God as a vine. It's in Deuteronomy, it's in 1 Kings 6. There's a golden vine draped across the porch of the temple. Psalm 80 particularly, if you read nothing else, read Psalm 80. It's all about Israel being the vine, and then finally God raising up a man who is the vine, a son who is the vine. As the old vine, Israel is burnt and doesn't achieve its full purpose. In Ezekiel, in Isaiah, in Jeremiah, in Hosea, always referring to Israel as the vine. Here are some interesting facts for you. Did you know that during the Maccabean revolt in BC 70, the coinage they brought out, on one side of the coin was a vine. It was like saying, this is our national symbol. This is who we are. We are the vine of God. This is who we are. There are so many references to the vine in the Old Testament. Israel is the failed, imperfect type and shadow of the true vine, which is Jesus. He is the perfect, true vine of God. Now, I'm no gardener. I seem to manage to kill plants and fertilize weeds. That seems to be my skill. However, there are some facts I've learned about vines. It's a utilitarian plant. It's not the most beautiful plant. It produces big fruit, small flowers. And the minute the fruit is harvested, I hope I haven't got any vintners here this morning who are going to put me right after the service. The minute after the fruit is harvested, they are pruned back. It's not supposed to be an object of beauty. The whole point is fruitfulness. The point of mission is fruitfulness for the kingdom of God. Many souls saved. Many people touched by the love of Jesus. It's not a self-serving thing. It's not just about our own personal relationship with the Lord, although that, of course, is central. It's about reaching the lost, the last and the least, with the love of Jesus, with the words of life. This is what Jesus is speaking about to his disciples. I don't know if you're seeing a different spin on these few verses. I certainly have, because I've not really heard them applied in that particular way before. The vine image is about mission. It's about reaching. Israel never reached to its missionary call. Israel was supposed to be a light and a priest for the nations around it. Instead, they apostatized and sought out the gods of the nations around them. They absorbed the culture rather than projecting the culture of the King of Light out into the nations around them. They had a much higher call than they lived up to. Hence, Jesus came to be the perfect, the true vine. This is all about mission. It's why I chose these verses for today. TFM is all about mission. The Via Beata is all about mission. It's all about preaching the gospel with our lives, with our words, with our works. Well, Jesus gave his disciples within this passage some powerful principles for mission. We want to be successful, don't we, guys? We want to be fruitful. We don't want to run as those that beat the air. We've got limited time, limited resources. You've been so generous to us. We want to be as effective as we can. We want the maximum amount of Jesus to the maximum amount of people. That's a good kind of axiom to live by. I try and live by that. The maximum of Jesus to the maximum of people. Hallelujah. So Jesus gave some powerful principles for mission. There are seven I've picked out. You know, John seems to love his sevens. So does God. Keeping relationship with Jesus central in mission. Our missionary message only has authenticity to the degree that we know the God, the Jesus that we're preaching about. You know, if we're preaching about a stranger, if we're preaching about a concept, people will pick up on that straight away. If I'm speaking about my best friend, my truest friend, my captain, my brother, my elder brother, people are going to pick up on that. They're going to notice the difference. There's a concept and then there's a revelation. We want people to have a revelation of Jesus Christ. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Nothing, zilcho, nada. And yet, in our humanity, so often we think we can. We know really we can't, but we think somewhere in our minds, well, actually, you know, we know how to do this now. We can do mission. Maybe I'm speaking on behalf of TFM here, but the reality is we can't, and we can't produce any fruit except that we are vitally connected to the vine, the true vine, which is Jesus. The vine is a person. If we are attached to the true vine, we will bear much fruit. That's a promise. That's a reality. It's not about how clever we are. It's about how clever and how great Jesus is. If we're not connected, we will quickly wither up and die. No matter how much work, in inverted commas, we're doing for him, it won't have life. It won't have the hallmark of the Spirit attached to it. Prayer. When we live so close to God, and if you want to get close to Jesus, try doing some mission. Come on a TFM mission. Come on the Via Beata. You're going to find he's very close. You're going to find you're hearing his heartbeat. Because this is why we're here, ultimately, to share the good news about Jesus. It's not for us anymore. We're saved, those of us who are Christians. It's for the sake of the lost. We will find we're very close to the heart of Jesus as we engage in mission. And as such, because we are close to his heart, because we know his heart, here are some promises to hit you between the eyes. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish. This isn't a text verse for name it and claim it. I want a brand new Mercedes. I want a 5-bedroom house with 5 en suites and a gut, 5 acres and a horse. No, that's not how this is to be applied. It's in the light of global mission, caring about the lost. So much that we're willing to preach to those who hate us and despise us and persecute us. It's in the light of that kind of relationship, that kind of heart connected to Jesus, that we will be praying the right prayers and therefore we will receive the answers. That's the promise. Ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. On mission, as we're praying for the lost, we are so close to the heart of Jesus. He wants people saved more than we do. My goodness me, if we could only understand how much he loves the lost, we'd pray from a different place. I would pray from a different place. You may be ahead of me. And here's another promise. I will do whatever you ask in my name. We pray in the name of Jesus, no other name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Point 3, obedience is an outworking of love. We have a very flabby, kind of soppy, nonsense definition of love. In our culture, it can mean all sorts of things. I love chocolate, I love roses, I love to go to the horse races, I love it when this happens and that happens. It's not strong enough. Love has to be demonstrated by obedience. Obedience is the proof of love. There are so many people who say, well, I love Jesus, I love God. Well, if you're not obeying him, you don't love him. It's as simple as that. Obedience is the proof of love. And I'm saying this to myself this morning, I'm not aiming this at you, but delayed obedience is still disobedience. Instant obedience is what our King wants. Instant obedience. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love. And you are my friends if you do what I command. So let's ditch this nonsense about just having sentimental feelings, that's love. No, love is a strong thing. Love is a powerful thing. Love is stronger than death. If we love Jesus, we will obey his commands. And they're easy to understand. You know, they're not complicated. Very, very, very simple. Love God, love people. We can't say we are loving Jesus unless we are loving each other. That's brotherly love. Honestly, the team that I'm leading this week, we have just gelled, like, just the love and the the Philios love and the care for each other has just instantly kind of, it's awesome. But we can't say that we love God unless we love each other. And by this, all men will know that you are my disciples, that you have love for one another. I can raise my hands, I can say I'm praising Jesus and worshipping him as much as I like, but if I'm not expressing that love horizontally to my brothers and sisters, then it means nothing. It's just a concept. It's just smoke in the air, it's going to blow away. But if it's grounded in human relationships full of love and integrity and honesty, then it means a lot. It speaks, it prophesies an authentic Christ into a nation that needs him. This is my command, love each other. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen, cannot love God whom they have not seen. We know how much faith we've got by how loving we are to the person in front of us. Honestly, go away and think about that. That's the level of our faith, is how able we are to express love to the person in front of us. Some people are extremely easy to love. Some, it's a bit more of a challenge. But that's the test of our love. That's the proof of our love for Jesus. Number five, keeping the joy. We were speaking this morning about joyful Christians are extremely attractive into the world. Would you agree this nation needs some joy? Desperately, desperately needs some joy. Not happiness, you know, circumstantial things that change all the time. We can all be happy for a moment, you know, when we get a tax rebate or a new car or whatever it might be. But joy, this is a deeper quality. It's not dependent on external circumstances. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. Not incomplete joy, not dependent on, does everybody love me today? Am I doing well? It's complete in Christ. Joy is an acronym. Jesus first, others second, yourself last. No quicker way to joy than sacrificing our own wants and desires for the sake of others. That's where true joy in Christ is to be found. Not as the world tells us to do the opposite. That's where happiness is. The kingdom is a topsy-turvy kingdom. We find it as we lose our own lives. It's a wonderful thing when we step into it. But our flesh is continually pulling us back from that place. We want Jesus first. He will lead us in that way. Number seven, aim for the deep and sincere. Now, we live in a very superficial world. Instant hit for everything. Bright lights everywhere. You know, everything has to be microwaved. Don't make me wait. You know, do you find if you're in the queue in Tesco's, if we're even allowed in Tesco's now, as things open up, for two people in front of me, I'm sort of inwardly jumping up and down. Hurry up. How many items? They've got more than five items. We have to learn patience in the kingdom of God. Let's go for the deep and the sincere rather than superficial fruit. It's a lovely ego boost when something seems to happen instantly and someone shoots up. But often there's no foundation to those things. The roots don't go down and the first wind blows it over. We want to go for the deep and the authentic and the sincere, the lasting fruit that Jesus spoke about. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last. We want fruit that will last from these 3 days in Streatham. Not a lot of hot air and then we go off and there's nothing to show for it. We want deep fruit. That's what we're praying. Fruit that will last. And because we are in the true vine, we believe it will happen. And finally, humility. Staying Christ-like. Preaching the gospel of Christ. Of grace to those who persecute, mock, ridicule, even attack us. Just as with Israel, we're not chosen because of our specialness, because we're exceptionally clever or smart or know how it all works or especially spiritual. We're chosen because God needs a people through which to reach the world around him and around us. Would you agree? You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you. It's all about who's sending us. It's all about who's appointing us. It's all about who's anointing us. And the great news is it's the anointed one who is anointed us. It's the appointed one who is appointing us. It's the great missionary who's sending us out as secondary missionaries. Jesus, the start, the middle, the finish, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He is our everything. If we're connected to him, we will bear lasting fruit. We will find love. We will have that depth of relationship, that humility. We will have joy. We will have Jesus in the center, and our prayers will be answered, and we will live obedient lives in a very disobedient age. Thank you for listening. May you bear great fruit in these days and weeks to come. May you find the joy of Jesus in a new way. Amen.
come now to that part in the service where we say sorry to God for the things that we have done wrong. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let us then show our love for him by confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Together we say, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the God of love bring us back to himself. Forgive us our sins. And assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the collect for today. Lord of all power and might, the author and giver of all good things, graft in our hearts the love of your name. Increase in us true religion. Nourish us with all goodness, and of your great mercy, keep us in the same. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please stand for our creed. And let us say it together without the questions. Together we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please do be seated for our prayers of intercession, which Sue will bring us today.
Gracious God, it is our privilege to pray for your world and your people, and so we bring our prayers to you this morning. We pray, Father, for those affected by the flooding in Western Europe. Particularly, we're thinking of those in Germany, Belgium, the Netherlands, and Luxembourg. Father, we pray for those who have lost family and friends, their homes and livelihoods. Those frightened that the flooding will happen to them next. Father, we also pray for those affected by famine, particularly today thinking of Tigray province in Ethiopia. Some of you are aware that I worked there in the 70s, and so have a particular burden for the people there and for the friends I made. We pray for the Tigrinians as they face not only famine, but also civil unrest and ethnic cleansing. We pray for others also who live with war, unrest, death, and homelessness. We pray for those and for those children that know no different, and that has become their norm.
We pray, Father, for peace in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our church community, our life together in Christ, and our witness to the world. This weekend we thank you for bringing Daniel, Charles, Gordon, Theo and Paula to spend time with us, and we pray, Father, for their witness as they travel, that they will be kept in safety and all their needs will be provided. We pray for each person they meet, each person they witness to, the people that they meet along their travels, and just pray for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are unwell with COVID. We pray for Stephen and Margaret. We pray for those that have got long COVID, who have family members that have tested positive. We pray for them. We pray for their well-being going forward, and thank you that there's grants coming along for those doing research, and we pray for a positive outcome. And on a personal note, Father, I want to thank you that our little grandson, Quinn, is free of the COVID and has come out negative. And we do thank you for that. We also pray for those suffering with other illnesses and pray that they will feel your presence with them. And we just bring to mind, in just a moment of silence, those that particularly are known to us individually that we want to pray for that are unwell for any reason, whether it's physical or emotional or spiritual. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are mourning loved ones. We think of the family of Linda Parrish from this village who died recently. And in a moment of silence, we remember those family and friends that we have lost. And we thank you for the time we were able to spend with them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, every person we have mentioned in our hearts is known and loved by you. We entrust them to you in confidence and hope, knowing that you will use our prayers for their healing and well-being. For we ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who is alive forever with you and the Holy Spirit. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. time for me will be no more. Guide me gently, safely, oh, to thy shore.
Nice to hear a song in a different context and a different version than we're used to really think about the words, and it's just one that spoke to me, so thank you for indulging me. I'd like to invite Paula Preston up now to lead the second half of our service for the communion.
We come now to the peace. Am I on, Robert? Yeah. We come now to share the peace. At the confession, we check that we're right with the Lord. At the peace, we check that we're right with each other. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's share a COVID secure peace with each other. Peace be with you. We just wave. Wouldn't it be nice when we can shake hands and say peace be with you. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened wide arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it, gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And as our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to come in. Our hands were unclean, our hearts were unprepared. We were not fit even to eat the crumbs from under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation, and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that we may live, that he and we with him, and that we, with the whole company of Christ, may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen. Sadly, until COVID restrictions are lifted, we in the Church of England can only serve communion to you, the congregation, in one kind, simply the bread. But I'll receive the bread and the wine as a representation of that. So I say, draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and the blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you. And feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. If you normally take communion in your own church, of course, you're welcome here. If you prefer not to, or if you're not ready for that, then please just simply keep your hands to your side and I'll ask the Lord to bless you. And I'll serve you where you're seated. The body of Christ, broken for us. blood of Christ shed for us.
Hey!
and the prayer after communion, which we say together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Are we going to have a song before the blessing?
We have our final song, so please do stand for our final song. It's a song that probably most of you will not know, but it is a song that David Leeke, my husband Robert, and myself have come to love these past, 9 months or so. Usually in October we go to Scotland for half-term holiday, and we have been attending a church in Bewley up in the Highlands each time we go. And on their internet online services during COVID, this is a song that they end their services with at the end. And it's such a beautiful song. It I looked up the history of it. It was written by a Scottish vicar who has written several songs. Part of it is in an African language. So it does start off with an African language, and it means we walk his way. So please do stand, and it's lively. Do some dancing, do some moving, and enjoy this song. Please do stand.
May the love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. And the joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. And the blessing of the Lord Almighty, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit be among us and all those we love, now and forevermore. Amen. Amen.
So we pray you have a blessed week, and if you'd like to have some conversations with our missionaries, please do after church. We can meet outside and have some wonderful fellowship with each other. Have a blessed week.
Thank you.